Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you are in this world, and welcome to today's DevOps.com webinar. I'm Charlene O'Hanlon, moderator for today's event, and I welcome you. We've got a great webinar on tap today, but before we get it kicked off, we do have a couple of housekeeping items we need to go over. First of all, today's event is being recorded, so if you miss any or all of the event, you will receive a link post-event to access the webinar on demand. Also, we are taking questions from the audience today. So if you have a question for our presenter at any time during the webinar, please just go ahead and use that control panel, submit your question, and we should be able to take a few minutes before the end of the session to go through those audience questions. Okay, with that, we'll go ahead and kick things off. Today's webinar is continuous testing versus test automation. Our speaker today is Wayne Areola, who is the CMO at Tricentis. Welcome, Wayne. Thanks for joining me today.
Thanks, Charlene. I appreciate it. And thank you, everyone on the webinar, for joining us. Like Charlene said, my name is Wayne Areola. I've been in the software testing business for longer than I wish to admit sometimes, but about two decades. And I'm the author of the book, Continuous Testing for IT Leaders. And today, what I wanted to talk about was continuous testing versus test automation. Today, with DevOps and Agile and the ideas associated with continuous delivery, the game has changed when it comes to test automation. And the new mantra that's been out there is something called continuous testing. But there's a little bit of confusion of what's the difference and basically why should people care. And that's what I want to cover today. But before we start, let me play, if all goes well, this video real quick as an example of what we're going to face. So I'm sorry if there was a rendering issue. I saw some comments come through as we were playing the video that the sound was a little jumpy, or the video was a little jumpy rendering. So I apologize for that. Anyways, though, I think most people have probably seen the Lucy and Ethel chocolate scene. And if we use chocolate as a metaphor for bugs, and we use that conveyor belt as a metaphor for DevOps, I think we get the picture here. Today, there's very limited time in our day to do what we need in terms of test and test automation. Yet, the mantra associated with DevOps and continuous delivery is like the manager coming in and saying, speed it up a little. We're facing today an unprecedented level of business requirement to deliver differentiable software faster. Yet, most organizations that I'm engaging with today are still using primarily older methods of test and test automation to assist in their endeavors to produce quality software. Or, as I'll phrase this now, reduce the risk of a release candidate. And we're going to talk about what that means in a little bit. But for the agenda today, I want to talk about three primary items. What has changed? What are the three differences with continuous testing? And then some practice ideas in terms of testing at the speed of DevOps. So let's start with this poll question. And this is something that we've asked almost every time we're in front of an audience or when I'm in front of an audience or given a webinar. And it's not a poll question you're going to interact with, but I'd like you to keep in your mind your answer. How would you rate the success of test automation? Is it a total success story? Is it so-so? Or is it a failure? So we've been collecting metrics on this over a year now. And basically, the story is really interesting on how the success of test automation has morphed. So when you look at, when we go back to Q3 of 2016, you'll see that, you know, primarily people thought that a test automation was so-so. And then as we start to progress Q1 2017, Q3 2017, what you'll see is that this idea of success starts to drop a little bit, and this idea of failure starts to creep in. And then essentially in Q1 2018, we see that there's this radical shift in terms of this idea that test automation can be considered or might be considered a failure. And these are poll questions that we take. I take it while I'm at shows, at conferences, whether I'm doing a poll on a live broadcast like this. I'm sorry I didn't have the poll set up for us today. But what really is going on here? And as you dig into the answer behind this particular question, what you find is the requirements have changed. The business expectations have changed, placing test automation at kind of the crux of a decision point, saying, do we do what's required? And what's moving around us is not the fact that the test tools have changed. No, the business expectations have changed. And it's our first step of realizing the difference between what is test automation and what is should be considered continuous testing. I always find that interesting. For me, though, I think over the years of observing the tools and observing the idea of test automation, I think it's true to say that test automation has not kept its promise. For the way that we've expected our test automation to actually produce results in a very continuous automated fashion, we've produced, or today the industry is pretty much filtered with brittle test options, which makes test automation, when you consider maintenance and running it continuously, a brittle prospect. And what we still see today is that most organizations, if you survey global 2000 organizations, most organizations still rely on manual testing. And it's still, in this day and age, as we're sitting here in 2018, it's 80-20. It's 80% of organizations still heavily rely on manual testing as their primary method for exercising software. And only 20% of organizations have truly delved into advanced test automation. Now, I'm going to tell the dirty little secret behind this chart is that if you really go into the Global 500 or look at broader organizations or larger organizations, this rate of test automation actually drops, not significantly, but it dips to about 18%. Does anyone recognize this gentleman? This is essentially the last CEO of Nokia. And in 2013, in an address to the Nokia employees, he basically stated to the organization that we didn't do anything wrong, but somehow we lost. Now, for those of you who are maybe aged like I am, you know, my first mobile phone was a Nokia. My second mobile phone was a Nokia. My third and fourth mobile phone was a Nokia. The patents that Nokia has around mobile telecom the way that they led the industry in terms of this mobile world was incredible. You know, the research, the development, the patents they hold around mobile telephony is amazing. And I was certainly a customer for a long, long time. But then what happened? Along came the iPhone, changed the game, and essentially wiped out this behemoth, right? This long-standing entity. Obviously, it's owned by Microsoft now, but today, you know, back then in 2013, you had the CEO having to stand up and say, we didn't do anything wrong, but somehow we lost. It's the same thing with software testing today. We can stick to our old methods of doing things, but at the end of the day, we're going to be enveloped or get behind what's truly going to be expected of us in terms of delivering software. I thought this was a good analogy, because today, as we do our day-to-day work, it's hard to pick up from having our heads down at the desk, maintaining test suites, and developing new scripts for what we need to test for the current sprint. And it's hard to pick our head up and say, hey, I think we need to change something. Because quite honestly, we're working hard. We're working very hard. But if you take this lesson from Nokia, we don't want to lift our head up at the end of the day and say, uh-oh, we didn't do anything wrong, but somehow we lost. So what has changed? Well, in our industry associated with software testing, we have a lot of different components of this equation that has changed. It's people, it's process, it's technology, and it's also the vendors and the tools that we've been so accustomed to looking at. So let's talk about people. The biggest impact of people to software testing today has been this offshore equation, meaning that we looked at traditional onshore labor as a cost associated with, you know, basically $100K a year for a tester. And in the past decade and a half, people or managers sought to save money through labor arbitrage and go offshore, and essentially save 60% of that labor or overhead just by using offshore labor at about $40,000 per year. Yet the outcome of this endeavor was very questionable. Did we satisfy a cost equation? Yes. But did we satisfy a quality equation? And I think the overwhelming feedback on that question is no. Now, when Agile came into the picture and the idea of co-locating teams or embedding quality engineers into the sprint and the development staff came up, this labor arbitrage or offshore labor became even more of a challenge. And that idea of actually producing quality software was actually challenged significantly more as we started to co-locate and put testers onto Agile teams. So the people equation associated with software testing has certainly been challenged. From a process perspective, this is where I think we've felt the most pain. Most organizations, as we've looked at software testing, we found that testing was a time-boxed event. It had its place within the whole software development lifecycle. And we always knew that when it came time, the release date wasn't going to move. But the most malleable box associated with the release cycle was testing. So our time was always compressed. But we got used to this, right? We started to understand what was required here. And we learned how to prioritize tests in order to potentially meet the release date. But then the game changed. CI, continuous integration came in, continuous build started to happen, and the idea of having to test became much, much more distributed. And two ideas started to form here. First, was the test that we were producing the correct tests for the time horizon of the project? Meaning that if I was early in code creation, what could I do to provide the best feedback possible to the staff or the individual working on the code at that time? So we had a mismatch. And at this time, the idea of development testing, although the practices of development testing, such as static analysis, unit testing, component testing, were very well established, were significantly immature and primarily ignored. So we had a gap. And this is where the idea of the process disruption really started to change the game for test automation and continuous testing. Then what happened? Well, we had technology disruption, and we will continue to have technology disruption. But we knew we had initiatives like DevOps. We have new technology like cloud native architectures, which are bolstered by microservices and containers. We had compliance issues that are only going to get more tough, such as security, the safety critical marketplace, financial, FDA, or medical validation, automotive, aerospace type compliance. And then finally, in terms of what's changed, there's one major component that I don't believe we necessarily talk about so freely, which is the switching cost of software is at an all-time low. And let me explain that just a little bit. If you are working for an organization who delivers value through software, which should be every organization, as a consumer of that product or service, you as an end consumer, it's really easy to switch these days. And let me give you two examples. First of all, I think we all on the line have a smartphone, and I think we've downloaded an app. If that app doesn't necessarily meet our expectations, we have one very easy option to switch, and that is delete the app that doesn't meet our expectations. And of course, we all go for the free app first, and then we decide to spend a buck on the next app. But by the way, if that app we spent a buck on doesn't necessarily work for us, you know, what's our switching cost in terms of deleting? It's a dollar, and it's an all-time low. I'll give you another example. Just recently, I switched banks. I was with a very large bank in America, and I switched to another bank that's more on the West Coast. And I thought this was going to be an overwhelmingly daunting task, but really, what did I have to do? Not much. My biggest investment was I spent about an hour switching my bill pay over to the new interface and putting in the addresses there. But even that was pretty easy because the automation associated with address lookup and finding my payees were very, very quick. So the switching costs for me as an individual, moving because I didn't like the interface and the software I was using at one bank to another, was very, very simple. And this switching cost, which is at an all-time low, is also a driver for us as quality and test practitioners, meaning that we have to defend the user experience. And the fact that you can have people defect from your platform is a very simple endeavor today. So what else has changed? Well, the top tier vendors have changed. So the one piece of research that a lot of people look at is this Gartner a magic quadrant for software test automation. And here's the interesting thing. If you go back 5 years, essentially, to 2013, there were essentially 15 vendors on the Gartner MQ. Today, we're down to 9. And of those 9, only 6 were actually on the MQ in 2013. And the two perennial leaders, which were HPE, obviously got sold, and IBM divested their testing platform to be developed by HCL, is a huge indication that there is a major shift in our space. And when I say space, I mean the whole concept of software testing is at a pivot point, okay? And you see new leaders start to come onto the quadrant. In fact, you'll see, you know, organizations, and obviously I'm from Tricentis, so we like to present this one. But you'll see that there is a total transformation in terms of how this market is morphing. So, oops, trying to change slides here. So what else is going on? Analysts. So if you look at the analysts The one thing, and by the way, I've been in this industry for 20 years. The one thing that you'll never, ever see is the analysts align along a message set or on a concept. But with continuous testing, we have that. So today, if you look at Gartner or Teresa Lanowitz at Vogue or Forrester, what you find here is that the concept of continuous testing has penetrated the language of all the key analysts. And on top of that, the message associated with why and how you need to transform your testing is somewhat synonymous, meaning that this idea of having to switch from what you've done today into something that is different, more continuous, is essential for actually succeeding in today's market. And what I'm going to do in the next section is tell you what those three things are that you need to consider in terms of the transformation. So basically, what I just discussed in terms of people, process, technology, vendors, tools, and analysts is the fact that we're in a perfect storm of digital disruption when it comes to software testing. I always say when I'm at conferences as well is, this is the best time to be a tester. And it's the best time to be the tester because there's so much changing. And what it means is that it's up to us now to carve the future of how testing impacts our organization. And at this point in time, there's an inflection point, meaning that the organizations that we're working for today are hungry for this change, and they're hungry for making this transition work. And it's now time for us as software quality professionals to step up and make the transition into being a part of the higher echelon of the organization that's making decisions around the risk of a software release candidate. Okay, so let me shift a little bit here and talk about what are the three key differences between continuous testing and test automation. So first of all, what is continuous testing? It's the process of executing automated tests as part of a software delivery pipeline in order to obtain feedback on business risks, which is a key here, associated with a software release candidate as rapidly as possible. I love this definition. It's also on Wikipedia. We also wrote it, so I love this definition. And I love this definition because what it does is it sets testing apart. And it sets testing apart because what it's saying is that part of the software delivery pipeline, or the old school SDLC, right? We need to actually establish time horizons to deliver to the participants in that software release pipeline or delivery pipeline information that's pertinent to their job at a specific point in time. And we got to do that as fast as possible. So if I'm designing, I need information that's going to help me design better. If I'm architect, I need information that's going to help me architect better at a lower risk. If I'm coding, I need information that's going to allow me to actually not inject errors and give me rapid feedback on change impact. If I'm testing or integrating, I need to know what are my integration points and potential failure points associated with the changes I'm making with the application. If I'm doing an end-to-end test, I need rapid feedback associated with the user experience so I can predict the particular risk of this release candidate. And it's a major change in terms of what we have been doing in the past. So what are the three differences? The three differences are risk. And this is, like I just talked about, a feedback for better trade-off decisions between release scope, time, and quality. It's breadth. No longer can we necessarily be isolated by the concept or the borders of an application. Our world is highly interconnected, and APIs and microservices are making that much more so. So the breadth of the application or the boundaries associated with what we tested before are beginning to erode. And time. And I know time has always been considered a major issue for software testing. Yet time today needs two things. It's not only the speed in which we can actually produce results, but it's the phase in which those results are being delivered. So we got to think about our activity in phases as well. So let me go through this just a little bit and talk about software risk. So in last year with TechWell, we did a very comprehensive survey. Over 3,500 respondents contributed to this survey. It's currently, I think, still live on SurveyMonkey as well because we keep it going continuously, but this was a snapshot of the answers as of January 2018. And what we asked here is, do tests accurately reflect business risk? And the compelling way to read this chart today is, look at the senior managers. Only 14% of senior managers would respond that tests do, yes, they do, reflect business risk. Yet, roughly 43% of consultants and individual contributors, meaning testers, manual testers, believe that, roughly say yes, that the tests accurately reflect business risk. So this is a pretty major gap, okay? Obviously, in the no's, you can also see the overwhelming answer in terms of the senior manager. 65% of senior managers say no, that tests do not reflect business risk. But what's the real problem here? The real problem is the definition of business risk, not necessarily the delivery of tests. The idea here is that the senior manager is very well concerned with things that the tester might not be aware of. And by the way, that senior manager's VP and that VP's CIO and that CIO's CEO are looking at risk as you move up the chain very differently. And that risk, as software more and more and more becomes the interface of the business, becomes synonymous with business risk. Yet the majority of our tests today are built from the bottom up from a user story. Now, you could say, yeah, we're really good at building on our tests associated with the user story, but this bottom-up approach still doesn't necessarily encapsulate risk when it comes down to the question, can I release, can I not release? But this is pretty compelling survey results on this idea of risk. So I want to introduce one question, and by the way, if we walk away from this webinar with one thing in mind, I'd like it to be this question, meaning that as we evolve our software testing and software quality practices today, we must take into account that a new question must be asked. So everything we do must be associated with this one question. And that is, does the release candidate have an acceptable level of risk? Now, this is an absolutely loaded question. It means that the release candidate is understood to have a risk profile of its own. And within those components of risk that can be associated with this release candidate, there are thresholds associated with those components in which we could determine if there is an acceptable level of risk in the release candidate, okay? And this is hard to do. This is not easy work. It means that we gotta take a different approach in the way we're actually defining testing. Some call this risk-based testing. Some call this risk-based test design, but it's a must in terms of changing and converting to continuous testing. So how to achieve this type of quality with speed? There's a couple of different ways that people have described it in the marketplace. Some people call it policy. Some call it risk-based test design. But it basically follows these steps. That business risk drives the quality activities. That's it. You start top-down. And if performance is a major issue associated with your users, performance becomes a major component of the risk profile. Not an afterthought. If usability, if functionality associated with core components are high risk components, it becomes a higher priority. And by the way, this is not that simple as you begin to survey the components of your application or how you wish to profile the risk of your application. What comes into play here, which hasn't necessarily been considered before, is non-functional requirements become much, much more important to the overall description of risk versus does the change functionality work, which we've primarily been doing. The second thing is teams are trained and they collaborate on the risk definition. This risk definition then drives test case design, and test case design is then driven to protect that user experience versus the risk definition. And then the execution of those tests are prioritized per the risk definition. So in the case in which you have a time constraint, the prioritization of executing those tests are driven by risk, not necessarily driven by more intuitive execution of selection or selection of tests. Acceptance criteria is visible and measured. And then finally, the results of the quality activities are visible, not only just to testers, but to the business. And what this means is that the results of the testing activity are translated for the business as well. And in many cases, I do see that organizations have still these binary views of a test, meaning we run a test run and we have this nice green red pass fail ratio and we move on. That by no means is satisfactory when it comes to actually executing tests for continuous testing. So the second thing is time. And obviously we've all seen this pressure developed where the delivery cycle time, it used to be once a month and then maybe it's quarterly and then it's weekly and then it's days. But, we've all heard of the stories of Amazon releasing every 11.6 seconds, some sort of change where we get down to hours, minutes, and seconds. But this idea of releasing more often and continuously is certainly upon us and it's a reality. So cycle times are decreasing in terms of delivery. Yet we also know that the technical complexity and the rate of change associated with technology is increasing, which actually puts a little bit more of a challenge on us when it comes to actually software quality. And by the way, we always go through an iterative process in terms of speed and complexity and rebalancing it. Today, as we see the evolution of DevOps and scaled agile, there's a gap. Today, there is a gap between what can be executed more automatically and from a risk perspective and time in terms of what we would like to accomplish. And that gap is what is producing this demand for continuous testing today. And by the way, we're going to keep on marching down this path. The delivery cycle time will continue to decrease. And the technology complexity and the rate of change will continue to increase. And we are going to shimmy down these gaps, closing out that disruption point at every point in the cycle. Today, continuous testing is the mantra to close the current gap associated with technical complexity and time. So I introduced this concept a little bit earlier in the presentation, but I want to go through it one more time. So today, officially, if you look at reports like the World Quality Report, the Wipro Software Survey, and I think there's a ton of these separate reports out there. One of them is by Forrester, which is a fantastic report in terms of software quality automation, software test automation. What you'll find is that the overall degree or of test automation is roughly 20%. Okay. Now, if you look at enterprises, and I'm talking about you carve out all the smaller niche, more nimble, maybe more flexible, more agile players that don't necessarily have a tremendous amount of overhead associated with compliance or a lot of corporate overhead associated with them, the actual test automation degree drops to 8%. But I'm going to challenge that one more time. Because when you do look at the health of these regression test suites or these functional automation test suites, what you do find is that the level of false positives, as well as the test bloat associated with these test suites, are overwhelming. And what's happening is the test bloat, as well as the false positives, are actually what's crushing our time when it comes to maintaining the test suites, which puts us in an imbalance between testing what's coming up new and fixing the regression suite in order to exercise and protect the end user against their former expectations. So today, when it nets out, and this is my guess, I think we're really around 3% total automation. So the first thing that we need to do when we're converting to continuous testing is realize that automation is required, and that today this 80% of manual testing needs to really go away. And what we need to do is shift that paradigm. And the first shift that needs to happen is to really change the paradigm associated with API testing. API testing has obviously been around for a long time. I've been talking about API testing for longer than I can imagine. And by the way, what I do see from API testing, it's more in this unit test mode. And what I mean by that is it's become somewhat of a technical practice and not necessarily shifted over into mainstream testing, meaning that it is a suite of tests that has been built by some technical resource who owns the artifact and not necessarily built into the mainstream of test automation. And this needs to shift. The idea of automated UI tests also need to increase. And this is where I believe organizations can have the biggest net gain. Today, what we find out there is scripted technologies are, quite honestly, dragging us down. There is a next generation of scriptless tools out there that give you the ability to achieve the automation rates that you expected from the old platforms. So the inflection point here is we need to change. The idea here is to leverage this new advanced technology, the scriptless forms, or this model-based test automation route, to actually achieve the test automation rates that we require for the speed of release. Okay? Today, if your organization is currently using scripted tools, I can guarantee you that we're going to be facing the same problems associated with test bloat as well as false positives as we faced in the previous decade. So this shift has to be a mental shift towards the idea of achieving consistent and persistent test automation rates. And then finally, this idea of exploratory testing, real exploratory testing, must be layered into our activities to inject human observation early into our sprint and release cycles. Exploratory testing gives us the ability with people with knowledge about the application to get the big block elements or big block errors out of the way early. And when done formally, we can certainly increase our overall test automation and as well as increase our overall quality. So real quick, we got about 10 minutes left. I want to go into some new practices or key practices you should consider associated with continuous testing. And let me just review it. Session-based exploratory testing, which I just mentioned briefly, risk-based prioritization and test case design, UI and API-based test automation, active test data management, service virtualization, and obviously continuous integration. So exploratory testing. So session-based exploratory testing is going to be critical. So putting the human review into an automated cycle as part of the sprint, giving you the ability to collect feedback rapidly in a session-based format is critical for success. And there's two reasons for it. First, you got to get those big block elements out of the way that are incorrect. And what you're doing here is you're truly defending the end user. And if done appropriately, session-based exploratory testing can be extraordinarily productive. Given a platform that can accommodate it, you collect the feedback automatically, no action is wasted, and you're able to get that feedback back to the development groups and QA teams rapidly. There's different approaches to this. You can wear different hats, which give people the ability to look at different views. You can do the supermodel tour. You can look at the security tour, usability tour, grammar tour. You can break apart people's purview of what they should be looking for in a session-based manner, inject it into the cycle as part of the whole iteration, and get phenomenal feedback from a user's perspective early in the process. The second thing here is looking at risk-based prioritization. I covered this a little bit earlier in my talk, but shifting your view to a risk-based view is imperative for continuous testing. We need to be able to tell the business that this release candidate has an acceptable level of risk, and there's no way to get there without necessarily having a risk-based view. In order to get to a true risk-based prioritization, you do need a tool. Intuitively, a human being can probably achieve about 40% risk coverage just by planning what they know is risky in the application. But you really do need a tool to assist you to plan these things, to keep your test and your test construction, as well as design, consistent as you begin or as that application begins to grow and expand. Finally, UI and API-based test automation. Both this type of automation can't be separated. We got to be considering this together in the same test suite, managed in the same manner, because the independent views of getting a set of results associated with API tests and then later on a set of results associated with UI tests is going to cause a problem. These two types of tests need to happen together, number one. And number two, they need to be managed in the exact same way. So from a maintenance perspective, a scriptless ability to actually manage this type of approach to testing is required, or we'll never get beyond the churn or bloat of the scripted technologies. So using a low-code, no-code type approach to both UI and API testing is going to be absolutely required if we are going to actually speed up the delivery of quality information. And you know, more specifically here is that the maintenance overhead associated with scripted technologies is really what's killing us. We need to eliminate that or reduce that as much as possible in order to keep pace with modern delivery cycles. And then two other components in terms of optimizing your test suite is active test data management, which means that we need to have stateful test data available and provisionable at any time in our process. And then finally here, looking at test-driven service virtualization. So for organizations that have not explored service virtualization is one of those keys that give you the ability to execute tests automatically and continuously. It assists you to actually exercise an application without necessarily having constraints associated with a full and complete test environment. Using service virtualization can get us the risk-based answers we desire in the time required. And then finally, automating all this continuous testing into your CI and CD pipelines so we can get consistent answers at the appropriate time horizon, which is required for more advanced delivery. Okay, I feel like I've just run a really quick marathon here. So I'm sorry for the elongated descriptions. It looks like we're doing pretty well on time. Let me just pose as I'm wrapping up here. If there's any questions, please put them into the question box that's on your GoToWebinar panel in that little drop-down area. So finally, what are the key points of continuous testing? And I encourage you to come to tricentis.com and look up what is continuous testing, because we will align this here. There's also a really good piece of collateral associated with the 14 points associated with continuous testing that you should consider. And it's a great start. So the primary goal is assessing business risk coverage. And if you think about it logically, we really can't go anywhere without it. We also want to establish a safety net that allows us to help other teams protect the end user, meaning we're able to actually rapidly deliver changes in the code base and provide that safety net for developers to make mistakes. We need an always-on stable test environment, leveraging advanced test data management techniques, as well as service virtualization to be able to execute tests, end-to-end tests, as effortlessly as possible. And finally here, or last two points, is seamless integration into your software delivery and CI pipelines, and then the ability to deliver actionable feedback appropriate for each stage of the delivery pipeline. And I can't emphasize this more. And this is probably the biggest gap, or what I see as the biggest gap, is that the traditional testing practices are meant to answer questions associated with a much, much different release cycle. We have to make sure that our tests are designed to deliver the feedback required at the appropriate time in the process itself. So, Charlene, are you still there? Hopefully, I didn't put you to sleep or anything like that.
No, not at all. Chock full of information, and we've gotten some great questions in so far. Great. So, do you want to just dive right on in and go for it?
Yeah. So, okay. I think there were some questions that were preceded by the audience.
Yep.
Prior to the.
Yeah. Do you want me to go over those first, or do you want me to go?
Yeah, maybe okay. One of those, and then yeah. A couple of the live ones here.
Yeah. Sure. Okay. So here's a good one. If we have not started with test automation, where should we start?
Wow. Okay. So this is a pretty good question, and it's a really broad question. So just for the audience's preview here, what we did is we actually sent out a questionnaire. You might have responded to it for questions prior to the event, so we could address them. And this was one of them. So where do you start? So from my perspective, it starts with risk, which means that we got to take a top-down view of understanding what is the risk profile of the business. And what's the most imperative components to protect that business? And it might not all be the same. Then what we need to do is take that risk profile and apply it to the unique applications or deliveries, delivery that we have. And this is what you'll see or hear about lately called value stream mapping. And those value stream mapping have very distinct and unique risk profiles per what is actually encompassed in the delivery. And it's imperative that we understand the risk associated with that candidate. That's number one. The second thing I would do immediately is look at where you're spending the most time in your manual efforts, right? When you get down to it, intuitively, you've sized down a series of tests that are the most important tests to run. And what I would do is I would look at scriptless technology to try to automate those as rapidly as possible. And what you're going to find is you're probably going to get about a 10x improvement in terms of execution time, which is going to allow you to free up your time to actually develop more tests. So that would be my quick and dirty answer on that one. Is there another question?
Yeah, we've got, we have automated, but it is still difficult to get tests to run consistently. So how do we solve that?
Okay. So not a lot of information on this question, but let me take a stab at it. What we usually find here is that scripts or scripted technology has been put in place in terms of defining a test. And then what happens is the test does not execute, and it doesn't execute because it usually hits a dependency issue. And the dependency issue is usually one of two things. One, insufficient test data. And test data provisioning, or two, what we usually find is that the test environment isn't necessarily available to execute the test as completely as required. So the test data management thing, I'd first like to say that out of all the tooling associated with test and test automation, test data management is probably one of the more exciting areas in terms of the level of automation that can be delivered
to get your tests as to run as effectively as possible. I know at Tricentis, we've invested heavily in a really cool stateless test data management type of system that is intimately integrated into our scriptless technologies that give you the ability to actually execute your tests as seamlessly as possible. Yet, this whole area of test data management has advanced considerably. There's also a couple of other issues that are pressing against test data management, which are data restriction and data privacy compliance requirements from Europe called GDPR, which has basically enforced this idea of having much, much more accurate test data management. The second thing I would encourage you to look at if you're not getting your tests to run as automatically as possible is look at this idea of service virtualization, which gives you the ability to actually pry your tests out of a dependent environment and giving you more automated responses. Service virtualization, in summary, is like stubs on steroids. It gives you the ability to actually exercise your tests without necessarily a complete test environment available.
Okay.
I think we have time for one more question.
Yeah. I'm going to go ahead and ask a question to the audience. But before I do, I want to let the audience know that we are not going to be able to get to all the questions, and I apologize for that. But if we don't get to your question, please know that Wayne is getting all of the questions from the audience. So he or somebody at Tricentis, I'm sure, would be more than happy to follow up with you post-event and get your question answered.
Perfect. Let me address the one on the bottom here, which I think just came in, which was testing is still too often seen as an activity after the fact, even though we try to do it in sprints. And by the way, I do agree with you. Moreover, it is positioned as a business responsibility. How can we change that? The reason why I selected this question is this: moreover, it's positioned as a business responsibility. How can we change that? Because that's interesting. I think your organization is not unique. And the fact that it is considered a business responsibility is actually a good thing. When I talked about risk-based testing, this almost inverts this idea of responsibility. And it drives the business to do what they should be doing, which is defining what the risks are of that interface to the business or the software to the business. What are the most important things to me, right? And once you do that and you change the paradigm in which tests are constructed, what you'll notice here is there's a few things that then can happen. First of all, the business gets to express their priorities without necessarily jumping down into the granular activity of test construction, maintenance, and management. Now, between you and I think the business is probably the most credible organization to actually to do this, and there's a level of end-to-end testing which I believe is still going to be required in a release cycle for the business to validate it, because ultimately they're the ones taking the risk, right? Yet, if you do take this risk-based view of the world, what you're now able to do is tier the activities down into actually translatable test practices. So what we have found, like let's take unit testing, for example. A unit testing run will execute, and basically we got this great 80-20 pass-fail, green-red, very binary view of what just happened in terms of a unit test run, right? Which gives the business no information. What does it mean? What kind of information can I walk away with? Having this business risk description associated at that level of granularity, associating the pass-fail to certain components that have a business impact, will also allow you to have a better conversation with the business, splitting the responsibility more evenly, rather than driving it from one segment to the other. I hope that answered your question. It's one of my favorite ones, by the way. Should we try to go for one more, Charlene?
Yeah. I think we have time for one more. How about this one? Does business risk include regulatory risk?
Absolutely. Business risk is anything that can impair the business. And I know with many of our clients, which are insurance and financial based, the compliance, and by the way, with the medical device organizations, right? Mm-hmm. The compliance element is the most critical point of the reporting and the documentation process. Does this have the most impact to the quality of the application, the quality of the actual overarching application? The answer is no. But is this a risk to the business if you don't comply? The answer is absolutely, right? So when we talk about compliance, it is definitely a facet that we must solve. And the good part about the compliance element is that the automation associated with the way these tests can be documented can solve that. However, I gotta say, what I've noticed lately is that a shift to a lot more distributed type of testing tools or scripted testing tools has somewhat broken down the paradigm in which the automated documentation is constructed. Mm-hmm. So using a continuous testing platform, for example, would allow you to alleviate this gap or this potential gap up front. Should we go for one more?
Why not? We like to live on the edge. Let's see. Okay, you mentioned all the changes in the recent year. Did the tester competencies change in the same way? And which are the competencies that have to be developed by testers?
That's a great question. So, by the way, I dub this. Did you know that this was a great question? Because it's a really good selection. So I call it the great debate. And there's a great debate going on today. And it's probably from a development and testing perspective, this is probably the most open idea associated with this idea of new software development and testing. And the concept has been dubbed SDET, or Software Development Engineering and Test. And the concept basically says that We don't necessarily need testers anymore. We will just have software development engineers in test do our testing. And this basically aligns directly with the question, which is what are the competencies out there that are being addressed or required? And let me try to answer the question as I have definitely an opinion about it, but I'm not going to share that. But let me try to answer it as evenly as possible. I can't hold my opinion back. There's no way you get rid of testers, okay? I'm sorry. There's no way you can get rid of testers. But the one thing I'd like you to consider is you have to look at the architecture of the application and application portfolio for the organization you're working for. If you're working in an organization that has a cloud-native environment with highly distributed, asynchronous microservices running the end-to-end user interaction. And there's a level of isolation associated with those independent or distributed components. You do have the ability to have this SDET, or software development engineer in test, or highly technical, scripted, highly technical, coded test work for you. But the only reason why it can is because you have highly distributed and isolated components of the application. And if you understand that component is solid, the idea is that it doesn't have an impact to the rest of the application. It's firing off asynchronously, it's firing off in a highly distributed manner. And if that's solid, the rest of the application has no impact. You can use this SDET type of idea. And this is where the tester, yes, they must shift their skill set. They must move from a more of a manual type of interface into something that is much, much more technical. And the second thing is, on the other end, your traditional end-to-end Global 2000 organizations who have very complex systems with compliance requirements, with complex functional interactions, highly integrated back-end systems, an ERP, and a system like SAP on top of a system of engagement like a web interface. You need a business tester here. You need someone who's going to understand the logic across those steps of the actual application. And you can't necessarily have the myopic view of what would be considered more of an SDET or software development engineering test type focus. When a developer is exercising and testing code, they're myopically looking at a component of that application and the code underneath that component. And it's hard to have the broader purview of the end-to-end impact of that change. So my idea here is, in terms of what skill set you need to have, it really depends on the architecture of your organization. And I think we're out of time.
Yeah, we are out of time. Thank you very much to everybody who submitted questions. Like I said before, you guys, I'm sure Wayne or somebody at Tricentis will be more than happy to follow up with you post-event. Also, if you missed any of the event, you will be receiving a link in an email to take you to the webinar on demand. The webinar will also be on devops.com on demand, so you can access it there. And then, Wayne, you've got a couple very quickly things that you want to talk about here on the slide, the papers?
Not at all. Just okay. Wanted to throw all it up there just in case Okay. Someone wants more detail on continuous testing. But thank you, everyone, for joining. Okay. I appreciate it.
Great. Well, thank you, Wayne, for such great information. I'm sure the audience got a lot out of it. And thank you to the audience for attending today. This is Charlene O'Hanlon, and I'm signing off. Have a great day, everybody.